If you want to understand what singing at its greatest could be, I recommend you listen to Caruso.
Caruso was the king of singers.
It was the voice that humanity wanted to hear.
He was a true showman every step of the way.
Whatever went on in Caruso's throat, it just aligned perfectly to make great sound.
Caruso's voice was a genetic miracle.
Only God, I guess, can make that. I mean, it happened.
If it's a really dreary day and you need the sun, I would recommend you listen to Caruso. Caruso was something different. He just was. He was musically different. He was vocally different, and he changed the course of music.
Every time I hear that voice, I hear, it's very difficult to understand and to explain to people, but you hear Napoli. You hear the Gulf of Napoli. You hear that sun pouring out. You see Vesuvius in the distance, and you just know that every time Caruso opened his mouth to sing, that he brought that part of him with him. That's what I get from listening to him anyway.
And this quality that he takes on that is just reminiscent of the place where he grew up and the Bay of Naples and his love for with all of his ambiguous feelings, he still loved his country and he loved his city. And you can hear that.
He was trying to present characters that he could identify with. And in his singing, you actually hear the emotion of the character that he's impersonating.
There were people going to the Met when I was going as a kid who had seen Caruso, and they knew him in person. Of course, the story they always told was, you have no idea what he sounded like because the records are a fifth of the greatness of his sound.
His interpretations, some of them are unduplicatable, because as we know, the two arias from Pagliacci, there has not been a singer, and God knows there were many who sang the role of Canio, who could come close, even remotely close to the 1907 Vestula Tuba and the No Pagliaccio Non song. Nobody can sing and deliver those pieces with that kind of communicative values that Caruso had in those two areas.
We have to remember with people like Caruso, and not only him, but they sang for a living. They practiced every day. They tried phrases over and over. Nothing was haphazard with these people. They knew what was coming out of their mouth. They planned it. They wanted to come a certain way. And that came from incredibly hard work. Yes, Caruso was talented in a way that very few people are in any field. But he also worked very hard. He sang every day. He learned music every day. repertoire he sang was something that was not necessarily out there to be picked off a tree. He found it. He wanted to know about music. He wanted to increase his knowledge of music.
Where the voice opens up and it kind of radiates this energy that I don't think has ever been matched.
Of course, we will hear an aria by 10 or 15 or 20 different singers. And of course, the comparisons that were made always, and Caruso will come always ahead.
When we tenor talk, we always say Caruso and the other, because Caruso is there, up there.
There were a number of tenors who were inspired by Caruso, and but that particular image, not to copy, but let's say to draw ideas about phrasing, about how to approach a certain difficulty in the technique, and what you could glean from listening to Caruso was a great lesson. It had a great impact on the selection to this day that tenors in particular will refer to, because they were part of the Caruso lexicon.
Remembering Caruso, who was such an inspiration to all of us.
Nobody wanted to record. Singers thought it was ridiculous. They thought it was fake. Who needs to hear a recording? And suddenly Caruso did it, and he did it so well that it became the thing to do.
people thought it was a fad. People didn't really think it was going to go anywhere. And Caruso believed differently. And so when he negotiated his contracts, instead of taking a fee and a buyout and walking away, which is what almost all of the other artists that recorded at the time did, Caruso negotiated a lower fee but a residual payback in perpetuity. To this day, Caruso's heirs receive a royalty check because of his recordings.
He was important to the Met. He was important also because his presence there made other singers come to America and sing there.
He was a champion of new work. And so many of the operas that we consider standard repertoire today were sung either in their premiere or within the first year of their composition by Caruso. And then his recording of excerpts from these operas ultimately made them so famous. So the famous arias from Rigoletto and Tosca and Madame Butterfly that are all recorded by Caruso, which became popular at the time and everyone knew them. They knew them because of Caruso and his recordings.
Caruso would be absolutely amazed at how many people still remember him and care for him and love his music.
Everybody knew Verdi. Even if you didn't like opera, you knew Verdi. You knew about Puccini, you knew Schubert, you knew Beethoven. Until Caruso came along, and then the performers became important. Everybody knew who Caruso was and maybe respected his privacy, but boy, did they point him out and go home and say, I saw Caruso today. If you were one of those people, you really can't walk down the streets. And that's how Caruso was. If you want to hear how a great singer can change the course of music, I would listen to what came before Caruso and then listen to Caruso.
My grandfather told me that at that moment, being on stage with this energy and hearing the voice of Caruso sail out into the Academy of Music in Philadelphia and come back, because the voice would sail out into the house and then come back and surround you, my grandfather completely lost composure. He was so emotional at what he heard and what he was experiencing that at the point that Caruso finished the aria, you know, it's time for the Capitano to say something. Caruso looked at my grandfather, and my grandfather looked back with this frightened expression, and Caruso gave him the words, and the rest of the scene finished. But my grandfather said his knees were shaking so much that Caruso grabbed him around the legs to hold him from falling.
I am so proud to have been in charge of Enrico Caruso Museum, which to my knowledge is the biggest undertaking by anyone alive today. There were many people who loved Caruso, had collections, and I remember many stories about some of them who sold the collections or gave them away. My intentions always was to have a permanent museum for Caruso, and I am doing that now.
When I started to go to opera at age 13, people told me that, all right, you like opera now and you listen to singers, but wait till you hear Caruso. So I waited until I heard Caruso on the radio. The first item I ever heard by Caruso was the 1911 Celeste Aida. And even though I was a beginner and very young and inexperienced, I heard that I am hearing something really, really special.
Enrico Caruso's work managed to live until my mother passed away 21 years ago. So he had managed to leave enough residue, financial and other things, that it took care of her, Gloria, for her entire life. And her wish was that her ashes be with her father. Mm-hmm. And I was able to do that.
He would copy a vocal score note by note into a pad. And of course, his ability as a caricature artist, he could have been Al Hirschfeld before there was Hirschfeld. I mean, that's what he could do. He could look at somebody and immediately capture their essence and their personality and humor in them without being insulting, which is the mark of a great artist. You could see people draw caricatures of people and they make them look ugly and they make fun of them. And while Caruso was able to draw people, he made fun of them in a kind way, and it was kind of reverent. And he highlighted what they already knew. You know, it wasn't a secret. And he was very generous with his art. If he was in a restaurant and he saw somebody next to him, he'd draw on the back of the menu and hand the person a caricature on the back of a menu.
Caruso was different in the family, different with a fan, different with people at a party, different with people at a dinner reception. He would respond to the situation, and probably he was totally himself within the family. When everybody was used to him, okay, that's Enrico, he has a voice, he sings, and otherwise he's just, you know, Uncle Enrico or Cousin Enrico or whatever. And with Junior, he also went through phases because he was very fatherly when Enrico Junior was growing up with the governess in London. And he would see his father every time when he would be in London or come through London or take him home to Italy for the summer with the governess. And then when he became a teenager, he would treat him like a little man who needs no cuddling and you don't show too much emotion or too much affection. And when Enrico was at the age of trying to learn to swim, father taught him how to swim, but he was still afraid, so he just grabbed him and threw him in the water and told him to swim.
I always thought there was an interesting parallel between Caruso and Babe Ruth, the fact that these people that came from, you know, very basic, humble beginnings and went on to achieve an immortal status in their field. You know, when you think of Caruso in the music industry or in opera in particular, or when it comes to tenors, there he's the benchmark. That's what it is. That's what you aspire to be. If you can be a fraction of Caruso, you're doing well. Baseball players are the same way. It's all about Babe Ruth, you know, and Babe Ruth was, you know, born into, he was, you know, an orphan in poverty and whatnot, and went on to achieve amazing success, enormous wealth, and international celebrity from nothing. In December of 1920, and he was singing Nemorino and Elisia d'Amore in the Brooklyn Academy of Music. All of a sudden, during the first act, he gave a little cough and began to spit blood. He continued to sing, and he continued through the very, very long first act, and stagehands were handing him towels, and he was putting the towel to his mouth constantly, filling them up with blood and handing them, or there was a well on stage, and he used to drop the bloody towels into the well, and they would hand him another towel. And he sang through the first act, and it was the first and only time that Giulio Gatti-Casazza, the then general manager of the Met, decided to end a performance in the middle. Caruso went home that night, and Dorothy said it was the same as any other night. They were in the car going over the Brooklyn Bridge. She said the difference was it was early, and Caruso wasn't smoking. After several operations and a recuperating period in New York, Caruso needed to return to Italy. And so he sailed on the Presidente Wilson. He turned to the crowd and he said, "Goodbye, America, my beloved home. I'll return soon, and I will sing and sing and sing."
Now, his illness was totally unexpected. Yes, he had some chest problems in September, October, I am told, in the literature. But nobody expected that breakdown, which eventually was diagnosed as pleurisy. And when he finally recovered after six operations, again, I read it in the literature, I wasn't there. They finally expected him to recover. And when he sailed back to Italy, he himself expected himself to recover.
When they traveled to Naples, Caruso had a relapse and woke up in tremendous pain. Dorothy tried to find a doctor, but Italy is closed in the month of August, basically, for what they call Ferragosto. When they finally did find a doctor, the doctor was overwhelmed by the celebrity of Caruso and quite befuddled. In any case, they were able to sedate him. The following morning, on August 2nd, he woke up and the pain was back again. Dorothy Caruso remembers that the clock struck 9 just as he passed. It was a day of international mourning when he passed. It was the equivalent of the death of a head of state, because he was the equivalent of the head of state in the opera world, or in fact, show business for that matter. The Church of San Francesco e Paolo, which was reserved for the royal family, was opened for his funeral. The great tenor, his predecessor, Fernando di Lucia, sang at his funeral. The procession through Via Toledo and through Naples was unprecedented. And leading the procession was a giant wreath, which came from the city of New York. Caruso was brought to a temporary tomb and then ultimately entombed where he still is, in Del Pianto Cemetery outside of Naples.
The grave is well maintained, and it's a mausoleum, and there are people that put flowers there even to this day.
The amazing thing is that after all of his celebrity, after all of his travel, his time in America and everything else, as his biographer Andrew Farkas says, his cradle and his grave are but a few miles apart. Kings come and go. There's only one Caruso.
Marti al singhiozzo, il dolore.